loving the seemingly unlovable, also known as the life of a human being. We are created in this human form, and it is so easy to get lost in our human experience being the full truth of who and what we are. But in reality, it is an experience of divinity. It is not the whole of divinity. It is this amazing whatever it is that is the source and the creation creates itself in so many amazing forms. I really appreciate Doug's prayer this morning that the presence of divinity was here as the floor and the ceiling and the walls before we ever got here. Divinity was in the form of the homes that we woke up in the forms of the coffee maker that helped us wake up, in the form of the showers that helped us get a little more socially presentable, the clothes that make us really socially presentable, because that would be an interesting society. Just all show up really how we are. I suppose there are places where that happens. And I'm reasonably certain I'm grateful I'm not living in one of those places. At least not with the socialization that I have, because I would find it awkward. So all of those things are divinity too. But they're not all of divinity. And that's a flip that takes us a while to get. Everything is divinity, but everything is not all of divinity. There is so much more that we, in our human journey, will never even see. This space that we exist in is divinity. What we came out of that we have never even seen in this human form is divinity. What we will journey into when we are no longer in this form is divinity. And in this form, in this journey of humanity, those are off limits. Or are they? Because, see, we're conditioned to want it in form. We're conditioned to want to be able to pick up something and read about it. We want to be able to own it and possess it and make it our own. And I think where we really get to experience it is in this enormous, and I'll just be honest, for me, incomprehensibly large thing called love. Because it shows up in so many amazing ways. Now, there is a lot going on this planet right now. Within the last 60 days, we have had hurricanes and floods and fires that have literally decimated large communities. Right now, a significant portion of California is on fire, literally on fire. And it is so easy to get caught up in the physical. And I want to be really clear here, there is no part of me that is suggesting we put on spiritual blinders and bypass what's happening in the quite the opposite. That we embrace it. That we feel our feelings around it. And that we understand we don't have to love entire cities being decimated. We don't have to love an entire country, an entire island being decimated. And we get lost in, I can't love that. And I don't think anybody is telling us that's what we're supposed to love. We gotta go deeper. And instead of loving the circumstances, find a way to be love right in the middle of that circumstance. And if you have not availed yourself of reading some of the amazing stories that are coming out of Santa Rosa, if you want to see how much love can stand in the middle of tragedy, research, just Google Santa Rosa and see. There is the CEO of a company up in the Fountain Grove area. Used to be Hewlett Packard, I think it's Keysight now. He prioritized 1,500 employees over that company. He has done something so extraordinary. My first master's is an MBA. This is unheard of. Okay. He didn't care about the business. Whatever buildings burnt, they burnt. Where are my 1,500 employees? He was in Stuttgart, Germany, got a text message, got on a plane, and got back here immediately. He knows where all 1,500 employees are. He knows which ones are in the hospital, which ones have lost their homes, which ones have been evacuated, and immediately, within 72 hours, that man put a plan in place where anybody whose home burnt to the ground, they get $10,000 to help start the rebuild process. Right. Anybody who's been displaced from their home as an evacuation, he's given them $1,000. The company is continuing to pay every one of their employees while they can't come to work. There are hotels that are opening their doors to people. There are people who own property who are waiving all of the deposits and all of the application stuff and first month's rent. There are just such an amazing outpouring of total strangers. Come into my house, you can shower, you can do your laundry. What do you need? People who don't even know one another. And what strikes me is if we look at the Bible and the book of Revelations, a whole lot of what's happening right now looks like what's described in that book of Revelations as the end times. And all week long, I've been sitting with that in the context of this loving, the seemingly unlovable. Because creationists, being raised in that faith tradition for most of my childhood, interpret Revelations as the decimation of humanity and the returning of one person whose name is Christ. And when I take a step back and really look at the end, what I'm seeing is the end of separation. Because in these crises, there is no separation. Nobody cares who you worship. Nobody cares where you were born, what your economic status is, what color of skin you have, what country you immigrated from. Nobody cares. When you show up in a boat to save me from a flood, I have yet to read any article where somebody stood there on their roof and said, "Before I get in your boat, who do you worship?" get in your boat, what country did you come here from? Nobody in Santa Rosa has stopped a fireman from putting out the fire based on their parentage. It isn't happening. And so maybe, just maybe, the end times are here. And we are standing squarely in an opportunity to end separation. To end this, you go over there and I'll go over here. And if we can just tap into remembering this place of oneness without the crisis, that maybe the second coming is not a person, but a Christ consciousness that is within every one of us. It was born in us. We don't have to search for it. Rumi says it best. It is not ours to create more love, but rather to remove the barriers that we've created against it. These crises remove the barriers that we have created against love. In the moment of life or death, those barriers are gone. So how do we remember that when the crisis is over? Because we're really good as a human race. If any of you have seen the movie Starman, it's an older movie.
Yeah.
Remember at the end of that movie? Mm-hmm. When there's a tipping point where he's either going to get to go home or the scientists are going to hang on to him to study him. And the scientist makes the decision to let him go, but first he wants to know, what have you learned about us? And he talks a little bit about our intelligence and our brutality as a human race. And the very last thing he says is, can I tell you what I find beautiful about you? And the scientist nods his head. And what he says is, you are at your very best when things are worst. And we're seeing that. And what I'm seeing is because the barriers are removed, we are taken to a place of soul-to-soul connection. How do we stay there? That's my question. How do we stay there? These teachings give us a platform to stay there. They give us a roadmap to stay there. The first thing I have to do is find that place of love within me that is beyond my attachment to this physical realm. Okay. One of the things I've spent an enormous amount of time this week in service to the folks in Santa Rosa from my home, because I couldn't get to Santa Rosa, and quite honestly, I would just be in the way if I was there. And so, what is mine to do here? And we listen, because we all have different gifts. And one of the things is we have a tendency to look at what other people are giving and go, but I can't do that. And we look at how somebody else is showing up, but I can't do that. And how often do we go inward and say, what can I do? What is mine to do? How does love as me want to show up today? And it may be as simple as praying. It may be as simple as recognizing that, wow, I would have no clue what to do if I were in this emergency. And so you educate yourself so that you learn from someone else's experience and you share that with somebody else. Love shows up in an infinite number of ways and forms. But in order to get there, I have to be willing to ask the question, where is the love in me and what is it calling me to do? Because see, this notion that we can control nature, that's not what our teachings teach. I had the opportunity to hear Reverend Dr. Barbara Waterhouse in Asheville, North Carolina, about a month ago, when Irma was coming through. And I'm not sure if I was going to get home or not, because Irma might have had different plans. And I really appreciate what she said, is that she's gotten an enormous amount of prayer requests to pray that the hurricane stops. And what she said is, I'm not going to do that. Because nature has its own way. Nature has its own balance. What I am praying for, and what I will always pray for, is for people's awareness, for people's safety, for people's highest and best experience of this circumstance, that they know that they are loved and cared for no matter what. Are we praying, trying to control something that we absolutely cannot control? Or are we dipping into the connection of oneness and standing with people right where we can? I've seen and listened to a lot of folks this week, and they're angry at spiritual bypass. They're tired of people telling them it's only stuff. You can replace your stuff. Well, some things we can't replace in this human realm. I talked to somebody who had the ashes of their parents in their home. And now those ashes are all mixed in with the 2 feet of ashes that is now their 3-story home. You can't fix that. And we need to find a way to stand in the discomfort of that in the physical realm, and at the same time know that love hasn't gone anywhere. That our physical earthly experience doesn't have to be in conflict with love. That they absolutely stand together. It's hard to see the magnificence of fire when it's wiping out your neighborhood. And yet, when we take a step back, fire is an amazing creation of divinity. It is a living, moving, breathing, energetic expression of divinity. And when we're cold in the wintertime, we welcome it. In fact, we create it, and we celebrate it. Put it in a different context, and we demonize it. It's the same love. It's the same creation. The hard part of this human journey is reconciling those. And honestly, the only place I know how to do that is on my knees. I've gone from praying in my chair to praying on my knees. Not in supplication to anything, but for me, it levels me. It reduces my attachment to this human form. I'm not kneeling to something. I'm kneeling deeper into something. I'm getting myself as far, as close to earth as I can get, so that I'm not even conscious of my rear end in a chair because it's a distraction right now. It's an attachment. Everybody has an opportunity to find their own way to that inward place. But what I really want you to know is that it's there. Principle is never bound by precedent. We teach principle. What happened yesterday, what happened 30 seconds ago, does not dictate what's going to happen now. We have an opportunity to truly learn to live in the now. Folks that are absorbing the loss of their home, that's in the now. And yet, they got a foot in the then. Because I defy any of us to go to our home that is a pile of ashes and not think about what used to be there. And I don't think we're supposed to. And what would it be like if we allowed ourselves and one another to stand there at this altar of our lives and simply be with ourselves in whatever comes alive in us? To allow grief and grace to embrace in that moment. That we don't have to do one or the other. Can we allow ourselves to start living in a both and? And even from the big stuff, can I let myself be in a both and when I set my alarm for 6 o'clock and I wake up at 7? Can I let that be okay? Can I feel my frustration? Recognize that, man, dude, you are like running down a road, and while you're running down this road of catastrophe, you're wasting time that you're complaining you don't have now. See, what if we allowed ourselves to go, okay, yeah, overslept, all is well, to tap into that place of love that truly knows nothing has gone wrong on the spiritual side. That nothing has gone wrong. Everything feels wrong in the moment. When I lose a job that I really love, can I be in the presence of love and feel all my human feelings? Because I think that's where the power is. This idea that there's something outside of us punishing us. I read the Old Testament, and the more I read it, the more it really looks like we're trying to understand weather. That there are floods and famine and all these, you know, it talks about wildfires. And it talks about tornadoes. And we blame them on some deity that we can't see. And if we appease that deity, this stuff will stop. And I kept going, this is about weather. This is about understanding weather. And as we evolve as humanity, we learn that if that were truly to happen, if there were some deity that we cannot see that we could actually appease to stop nature, we wouldn't have nature. I don't think that's what we want. I think what we want is to be comfortable in our skin. We want to be comfortable in our human experience. And we are here for so much more. We are vehicles where divinity itself shows up. God, Buddha, Allah, Great Spirit, whatever you call it, needs you. It needs you. It created you as a vehicle to express it. What I am really, really aware of is the more I'm attached to the stuff of this, the less of it I bring forward. What would it be like if we all just lived in gratitude for the physical, lived from that place within us that is uniquely us, that is uniquely ours to bring forward, without qualification, without making others qualify to experience our divinity? What would happen on this planet? I'll tell you what would happen. Peace. Peace will happen on this planet when I stop withholding the brilliance that is mine to bring forward until you qualify to get it. Because what created us doesn't make us qualify. It loves us, and it loves us, and it loves us no matter what we do. Even if we abjectly deny that it exists, it loves us. We didn't create that love, and here's the good news. You can't uncreate it. There is nothing you can do to make what created you stop loving you. And so my invitation to you this morning is to love that way. To take the love that you have been given, the love that was born in you, and give it away the same way you get it. Stop making one another qualify. Stop waiting for people to agree with you before you love them. Stop waiting for the political climate to match your agenda before you love people, because it's never going to happen. It will happen when we love one another. When we literally, from the depths of our being, just love one another. Everything else will take care of itself. Let's take this into prayer. What I know in this moment is that there's one infinite, ever-present source, and it is here. And here is everywhere. No boundaries, no limits, no qualifiers. Just love, giving itself with complete abandon, with complete joy to every element of its creation. Because this one is all there is, because it creates out of itself into individualized expressions of itself. We must all be that. And so the way it loves is in us. And so I speak my word as that, on the authority of that love. That each and every one of us steps into a greater expression of loving. Beyond the circumstances, beyond the impact, beyond our opinions, that we dedicate our being to being a place where love shows up in the midst of everything, every time, in the unique and magnificent way that we are called to show up. I'm so incredibly grateful to have the peace within that knows truth, that knows that every individual I encounter, every situation that I encounter, love is right there. Grateful to have the opportunity to see it, and to stand in it, and to be its greatest expression that I can be. And so in this gratitude, I release my word into that activity of love and law that only knows yes, that says yes as we speak it, that loves us so completely, it has no no. And so as I release, I invite you to join me in anchoring this together.